hand full, the other hand empty, both hands gone full as he grasped the back of his shirt and stripped it fluidly off over his head. The shirt dropping and the same hand hovering at her own chest, parting the buttons of her shirt, then tugging the shirt back and down by the collar until it hung just above her elbows like a wrap now, shoulders bare. He let the collar go and one hand fell empty again and moved to draw her in, she too startled to resist the half-nude embrace. The warm, dry feel of chest against shoulder, arms wrapped about her, empty hand flat and spread flat across her back, full hand all knuckled up around the gun and granching against her side. She still could not move at the cessation of the embrace. Might never have moved had it not been for him now tugging her before the mirror, his arm around her shoulders, drawing her in and tight until they both stood configured in the silver glass, shoulders up. Shoulder to shoulder, both seemingly bare, her neck blotching now, his arm drifting over now to drape fingers over her ear. And then his gunless hand pulling their heads together, pressing ear to ear as she watched still in the mirror, his other hand now rising to lift the gun to his own temple, aiming through his head at her own. She observed the flattened image steady the pistol, press it hard against the free side of his skull, cock, fire. Face no more than a dark blur at first, and then still a blur but clearer. The other man behind her, holding her head at the temples and forcing it forward, demanding she regard what he claimed to be her reflection. There, in the bright pocked metal, the shaved temple, the dark blister of blood where a fragment of bullet had passed through his head and touched hers. Perhaps any number of heads, she thought. Hardly my head, she thought, as the other man spoke urgently and psychiatrically at her, at the odd, blurred visage in the metal tabletop, which she could not accept as her own. It was his visage she was looking at, she realized of a sudden, his preserved head. She knew the other side of the head where the bullet had burst forth was a ruin, would be a ruin still, but she did not dare turn her head to see. If she does not turn her head, she can still consider herself to be herself head to tail, even if her head is his head. Even if she does not know the whereabouts of his bony body, wandering and armatured with her own head. He now roamed woman-faced, now excellent and incognito, while she has ended up male-visaged and always in danger of collapse, always just seconds before the sound of the gun as it goes off, the burn of powder and the pain in the head as she falls, her doubled image gone bloody and slipping from the mirror. They are calling the hour now, the other man long gone from behind her, the night watchman coaxing her up from the table and down the shadowed hall. The final vision pursuing her now and catching at her heels. Ephemerated movements and disrupted forms spinning along fresh polished floors. She knows it is the cast of her own legs and feet she is seeing, the feet of the night watchman as well. Perhaps here and there glimpses of her head and other parts. But there seems more than that, a supplemental furzing of shadow and color which she knows is the coming into being of his particular vision. Soon, in the shadows of her room, the locked door, the steps of night watchmen crossing up and down halls, the vision will nearly claim discrete shape. His form a dim phantasm entorting in the shadows of the room, congealing and fading over the night's course. She shall rise from the bed to try to capture him in her blanket, try to retrieve her head. But each time she believes to have him, he will reveal himself just over her shoulder, laughing with her voice, her lips, as she herself knits his furrowed brow and tries again. Then later, morning, the blanket empty, the door snapping open, and she will be drawn back down the corridor again into the same day she has just left, knowing at both ends of the corridor he shall await her, full and empty-handed, and no place for her to turn but toward him.
One. Early evening, still distant from the prairie, we encountered a man with skin flayed half free of his back. He allowed us to inspect that portion of him, and we saw the underskin, purpled and creased with folds that in their convolution resembled the human brain. The runs off his back he had tanned and twisted into a belt, which he wore and which our captain tried, unsuccessfully, to purchase of him. When our physician inquired after the particulars of his persecutor, the man answered by unfurling from his rucksack a flapping sheet of skin with a large and hardened callus awash at one end of it, which, upon formal inspection, proved an empty, flaccid face. Two. Our parochial of late has taken to baptizing all we encounter, tallying their particulars on wound scrolls before they are slaughtered. As we walk, he counts the names, phrases aloud to us the petitions he will employ before the church as, spreading forth his list of converts, he renders plea for sainthood. 3. The air is fumid, choking. Near midday, we were greeted by a man who made claim to raise the dead. Our captain bared his weapon and lopped the head from Rusk, with whom he has been at odds throughout the voyage, and then bade the man have at his task. The self-appointed Jesus sewed Rusk's head back onto the frame and then, with shaking fingers, uttered his shallow pronouncements. After ample wait, the captain ordered this fellow's head struck from his shoulders as well. We carried the head spike-shafted and passed onward. Nearing the prairie, they began to mumble, at which we sand-sunk their shafts, abandoned them. 4. We've reached the prairie, the dead progressing in droves through shackle and quaking grass. We captured one, and he was drawn forth with little struggle, falling nearly insensate once raised from the ground. His flesh was dark and stinking. We examined his armature, the way his mouth had been re-sewn and mandibled. Availing the membrane lining the chest, we found the internal organs neatly removed, lower orifices stoppered. With slight pressure of his palm, our physician sloughed away the skin that remnanted to the skull, then exposed the upper portion of the brain case by means of a rack saw. The brain had been removed, the emptied interior case showing in its blotchwork signs of psoriasis or, as it is commonly called, sideration. Our physician made severe notes and, when done, asked for the sake of experiment that the body be released. We lowered it to the earth and watched it come animate, stumble away. 5. During the night, Latour harnessed a dead woman, for we have been long on the road. Devoid of resilience, she came too rapidly asunder beneath his hips. Even with eyes gritted shut, he could gain no satisfaction. The parochial refused his confession. 6. At times, one discovers the living hidden among the dead, the which can be discerned by the color manifest in their flesh, the sentience of their regard. They crouch to the center of a drove, allowing the dead to sweep them along. One we managed to capture. When he made pretense of death, the physician pierced him with his instruments until the man could not but grow bloody and roar. We jointed his limbs, packed them in salt. His eyes shuddered and then opened again, his torso regaining a torpid motion. We watched his body struggle out and away from us. His boxed limbs thumped against the lid, grinding the salt. 7. We've consumed the remaining provisions. We eat the living when we ferret them out and have eaten the horses as well. Still, the prairie continues without cease. The dead prove too festered and rizzard to consume. Instead, we encircle them and employ them as mounts. We tie them by twos front to back and lop free the heads. Sitting on the planed necks and shoulders, we goad them to motion by prodding the forward remnant of the brain's roots. 8. The prairie is subdued in dust and sand, footing given away. The dead are sparser and often balsamated, their armature careful and fresh. There is no sign of who has prepared them. This morning we saw approaching at some distance a lone figure with a purposiveness that proved him still alive. When he came closer, he was seen to be slung with a large sack, groaning beneath its weight. He attempted flight, but mounted athwart the dead, we soon rode him down. Dropping the sack, he murdered Latour and Broche before being killed himself. We struck a fire and ate what we could of the newly dead, then slipped back the sack. Inside were two gray and curled women who stumbled away when released. We rode them down and coupled them severally. Later, we directed their movement by ropes slung about their necks. Later still, we ate their fleshly portions. 9. There is no water, no matter how deep we dig. All provision is gone. The dead here shot through with venom, so that upon consuming them, we die ourselves. Our parok is mad and wandering. Our physician is dead, and all the others dead too, but for the five of us. The physician pursues us with a sentience we have hitherto disallowed the dead. We awoke last morning to find him bestraddle the captain, whom he had killed, consuming the fellow's face. We drag the physician off, breaking his legs and plucking free his eyes to hinder further pursuit on his behalf. We broke the captain's legs as well. There is some discouragement among the men who remain, yet I have urged them to push forward, and for the instant they comply. This midday a glister at some distance and the movement of far figures like lice. We rode forward and found there what I must deem a templature for preparing the corpse, hastily abandoned, the heaped organs on its surface still spongy with blood. I've examined the apparatus at length but can make nothing of it nor of its functioning, though it has in my awkwardness contrived to lay bare my palm to the bone. The others, seeing my fate, destroyed the device before I could query it further. 11. My injured palm swells. I am without water, food. Save myself, the remainder of the party have returned, hoping to reach the edge of the prairie before dying. I have opted to continue, hoping to strive to the center and whatever is established there, if center there be. 12. There is no satisfaction anywhere. I wander among the dead, awaiting the moment when I shall pass imperceptibly from the stumbling of the living into the stumbling of the dead. Avant.
After I had killed Altman, I stood near Altman's corpse, watching the steam of the mud rising around it, obscuring what had once been Altman. Horst was whispering to me, "You must eat his tongue. If you eat his tongue, it will make you wise," Horst was whispering. "If you eat his tongue, it will make you speak the language of birds." I knocked Horst down and pointed the rifle, and then, as if by accident, squeezed the trigger. One moment I was listening to Horst's voice, his eyes brilliant, the language of birds, and the next I had killed him. I stared at the corpse next to Altman's corpse. It had been right to kill Altman, I thought. Given the choice to kill or not to kill Altman, I had chosen the former and had, in fact, made the correct choice. We go through life at every moment making choices, I thought. There are people, Altman among them, who, when you have sent a bullet through their skull, you know you've done the right thing. It is people like Altman who make the rest of it worthwhile, I thought. While people like Horst, when killed, confuse life further. The world is populated by Altmans and Horsts, the former of which one should riddle with bullets on the first possible occasion, the latter which one should perhaps kill, perhaps not. Who can say? I felt remarkably calm. I prided myself at that moment on my self-composure, taking a minute to sit down next to the two corpses, Altman and Horst, and to feel that calm to its greatest extent. This calm, I suppose, was not the result of killing Horst, but as one might expect, of killing Altman. There are two types of people, I thought, type Horst and type Altman. All people are either Horst or Altman. I am the sole exception. I repeated the phrase sole exception, alternating it with unique exception, trying to decide which was the better, unable to decide. I flew blackly about, smelling my foul feathers and flesh. I stuttered, spattered a path through the branches of trees, sprung fluttering into blank sky. Prancing. He herded them out in the madness of midday heat, butchered the horses before their eyes. He hitched each horse to the center post, hacked off its legs with his axe. The beast bucked and shied, limped, staggered, lay legless and mad-eyed, stumps a-wriggle. Their bodies roiled up slow drifts of dust while Bosephus cut through their necks, and even for a time thereafter. Their narrow heads remained dangling from bridles, astrain with flies. Guards cut up carcasses, dragged the pieces over the walls, committed them without further ceremony to the waste. "Blame the note," said Bosephus. He removed a scrap of yellow paper from his pocket, displayed it in his bloody hands. "I would allow you to eat your fill. Blame Thorn." Thorn was nowhere. They knocked at his door. They kicked against the bolt-studded metal. Not a word. Not a word. Josephus sat on the east wall in his canopied chair, his gun resting across his knees. He stared out, inscrutable and unaware, motionless as the horse heads. He stared through the field glasses at the hill, counting crosses. Ivar the Boneless and Roger Cuerpo stood guard at the corners of the west wall, watching birds fight for horse flesh. Cuerpo removed his rifle from his shoulder, fired three rounds, brought up flurries of feathers. Ivar smoked a cigarette and stared at Cuerpo, leaving his own gun to lean against the wall. At Thorn's door, the rest drew straws. It was Preeter Bedlam who drew short and was made to venture the courtyard. He shuffled through the blood mud, pushed his hand past the horse heads to grasp the sticky axe handle. He pulled the axe out of the circle of horse heads, flies and gore burning on his forearms. He looked to his cohorts, lifted the axe in salute. His eyes vanished into dark holes, the roar of shots echoing off the walls, the base of his skull scattering across the courtyard. "Instructions via Thorn," called out Bocephus. He broke the breech of his gun, shook out the casings. "Nothing personal," he said, reloading. He stood, moved his chair closer to the catwalk's edge. He adjusted the canopy, sat down. Elbows on knees, he aimed his rifle. Preeter Bedlam's corpse flinched a few inches across the courtyard. Josephus stood, turned his chair around to face the waste. He counted crosses. Sarah rapped thrice on the dusty wood. "Gloucester," hissed Sarah. "Gloucester, it's Sarah." His cohorts took turns throwing themselves against the door. The wood around the latch splintered away, and they forced the lock. They spilled in, threaded their way through the fallen stones. The holes the stones had left falling from the ceiling spattered them with tattered light. They chose a cylindrical stone which tightened to a tusk at one end. Four dragged the stone down the hall into the courtyard. They pushed it up the creaking rungs of the ladder, rolled it down the walkway to Thorn's door. The four heaved the stone up, took a few ponderous swings. The metal sang out and chimed. Josephus stood, stretched. He fumbled a few shells from his jacket pocket and pushed them into the shotgun. He lifted the gun, pointed it at each of the four in turn. "Any preference to first?" said Josephus. He pulled the first trigger, dropping a man. "Sorry," he said. "Second, I mean." He ran his hand lightly along the warm barrel, watching the three remaining carriers struggle to keep the stone aloft. "Not all decrees must be written," he said, and squeezed the second trigger. Those who dared come at first dark drove back the murder of dry black crows. They unhitched the horse heads by touch, dragged them by the reins back to their rooms. They cracked the long skulls against the walls, pried apart the bones to suck away the brains, stripped the hair back with fingernails to gnaw out the narrow pockets of hidden flesh, flecked lips, cheeks, tongue. Those who came later cut hunks from the five human corpses, picked apart and shit-sprant by birds. They warmed the meat over paper-fed fires in their rooms, choked their lukewarm fellows down. A few last, coming just prior to dawn, caught at flies, broke bones, sucked marrow. They masticated mouthfuls of blood-soaked mud, staved off hunger for another few hours. The underground karst. Gloucester sucked stones to deaden the hunger, gathering up tiny pebbles scattered through the tunnels. He licked mouthfuls of mayflies off the dirt walls, creatures all leg and wing. He lapped up whole colonies, wandered in search of more. He found a stone chamber whose floor sloped down to form a catch basin, the water of which he shared with rats. Asleep, he felt rats scurry across his feet and legs. He killed them when he caught them, trampling their bones and flesh into a thick, dirty paste. He scooped the paste off the dirt, choked it down. He switched on the flashlight and set it on end, mounding dirt around it to pin its beam to the ceiling. He took his possessions out of his backpack, put them back in again. He drew symbols in the dirt, rubbed them out with the heel of his boot. He dug through the clay at the edge of the chamber, turned up rocks. He clawed up fat white larvae, which tasted of rancid butter. Wandering the tunnels, he scraped arrows into the walls. The bore of the flash beam grew dim, reddened. The bulb's wire faded to a pale orange, died out. He fumbled another set of batteries from his backpack, hand-cranked the generator until the bulb was strong and white. With each charge, the batteries weakened. He slept where and when he pleased, the backpack pillowed beneath his head. He dreamt of insects worrying his eyelids, awoke to find creatures crawling within his clothing. He stripped, consuming all he could find of living things upon his scab-ridden bone heap. He dug a wolf spider out of its hole, swallowed it live. Its eight legs tapped days of indecipherable code against the lining of his stomach. His hair fell out in patches. He wove the strands into braided crowns. He placed the crowns atop his head, knotted them fast to the remaining tufts of his scalp. He smoked his last cigarette, filter and all. He wandered farther and farther from the staircase. Tunnels ran in all senses, twisting up and down. He started coughing, could not stop. Chambers became irregular, walls slanted inward or recessed, tunnels collapsing at a touch. Squeezing down stone chimneys, he grabbed handfuls of invisible bats. They nipped his ears and their spasmic ascents spattered him with a bitter ammoniac guano. He felt lightheaded, his feet pressed against the sides of dark and endlessly descending shafts. He scurried down chalky side passages, dragged his fingers along wet limestone. The puddles he moved through were a swarm with vital luminescences, lethargic creatures all eye and bone. On his knees, he lapped up water, fish, and slime. He traveled the riddled, expansive terrain of an underground karst, the ceiling so high that even a flash beam commanded by fresh batteries dared not reveal it. His footsteps echoed away into nothingness. The lava crust beneath his feet grew brittle, collapsed. He trod calf-deep imprints across this waste beneath the waste. He forced his way into a side fissure, hairy with moss. Scraping the moss off, he found veins of pale ants flowing beneath. He licked the wall, swallowed them whole. The ants stung his tongue, the inside of his cheeks, stung him all the way down his throat. His stomach numb and churning, he vomited all up, watching the still-living ants wander blindly across the shale. He kept retching, his face dripping a milky sweat, his ragged bones shaking off his remaining flesh. He wriggled through stalactites and stalagmites, waiting for his will to fail. Cramming himself into a crack, he let water trickle onto his head, down over his closed eyes, down his cheeks. Some seeped into the side of his mouth, the rest dripping off his chin, spreading in a dark stain under his shirt. He felt the spider moving about his stomach, building webs. Pale insects wove homes from the hair of his arms, burrowed their way into the loose folds of his fleshless skin. He swallowed all that crept into his open mouth. He sucked flies into his nose and hacked them out into his mouth. He waited in the dark, slowly shutting himself down, starting with the outer extremities, working inward, putting his parts aside one by one until only the thinnest slit of him was alive. He lay wedged and upright in the dark, starved. Once caught, Ivar struck Cuerpo in the throat and wrested the rifle from his grasp. Swinging the gun by the barrel, he struck Cuerpo just above the shoulder, broke Cuerpo's neck. He tore the sleeve off Cuerpo's shirt, stuffed it tight into the man's mouth. He sat down on the walkway, continued to eat the horse flesh. He wolfed hunks of meat, watched Cuerpo's eyes flutter. Josephus, Ivar saw, had remained in his chair on the opposite wall through it all, oblivious for staring out into the waste. Ivar cut the remaining horse meat into strips, spread it along the top of the wall. He looked again at Bosephus, saw no difference. He searched Querpo's pockets, took his cigarettes, matches, lucky coin. He dragged the wide-eyed and paralyzed Querpo to the edge of the wall and dumped him over. He smoked a cigarette, then watched the birds peck the man dead. None of this until Ivar cut fresh meat from Querpo himself and put that out to dry as well, for a rainy day. He had his hands full keeping the birds off the meat. Note in hand, Bosephus fumbled a book of matches from his back pocket. He bent one out, struck it alight. Needleman, siege, seal it off and wait for air to expire, brick the tomb, thorn. He crumpled the note, dropped it and the match down into the courtyard. He went through his pockets, searching for the other note, with the blank. He lit a new match, scanned the surface of his chair. He lit a third match, dropped to his knees, looked under the chair. Stepping slowly the length of the wall, he lit new matches, bringing each near to the ground. He let each sizzle dead against his horned and scarred fingertips, lit new ones until the matches were gone. He felt along the dark wall, touched the adjoined dark wall. He moved toward the faint glow of a cigarette. "Do you have a flashlight?" he said, arriving. "Querpo?" "No," said Ivar. "Ivar?" "No." "Lantern?" said Bosephus. "No." "Lighter?" "No," Ivar said. He snapped the safety off his rifle. "Matches?" said Bosephus. "I heard that," he said. "Please put the gun down." "I was flicking the safety on," said Ivar, "so I could put it down safely," he said. "I'm putting the gun down now," he said. He did not put the gun down. "Matches?" said Bosephus. "Two matches," Ivar said. "Give," said Bosephus. "And the cigarette." Ivar felt the matches and the cigarette leave his hand, catching a shadow of Bosephus' forearm as it shot out in full darkness and vanished back into it again. He listened to Bosephus move along the wall. Lifting his rifle, he tracked the dim glow. Indeed, would have shot had he known in which hand Bosephus held the cigarette. He kept a bead on the glow until the coal ashed over. Ivar stood, pursued Bosephus along the wall. Just past the corner, he saw a match flare up. By the time he was ready to shoot, the flame had vanished. He smashed into the corner, cursed, turned down the wall. A second match flared ahead, guttered. Ivar pushed forward a few steps. He stopped, listened. Hesitating, he retreated. "Guard," said Bosephus. "I'm here," said Ivar. "Did you hear footsteps?" Bosephus asked. "I heard them, yes." "Did the other guard pass?" asked Bosephus. "No," said Ivar. "Querpo, is it?" said Bosephus. "Not at his post?" "I haven't seen him," said Ivar. Bosephus stood silent in the darkness. "How?" he said. "Ivar, might I ask how you lit your cigarette?" "I found another match," said Ivar. "You gave me your matches," said Bosephus. "Just a last match," said Ivar, "loose in my shirt pocket," he said. "It must have fallen from the box." "You dare deceive me?" mused Bosephus. "No, sir," said Ivar. Ivar stayed stretched flat against the stones in the darkness, holding the glowing cigarette as far above his body as possible. His arm ached from holding it. He made his body flat, all but the arm. The cigarette coal shook, wavering in the darkness. "Stop that immediately," said Bosephus. Ivar stubbed out the cigarette. "Why did you do that?" asked Bosephus. "You counseled me to," said Ivar. "I counseled nothing of the kind," said Bosephus. Ivar said nothing. "No more matches?" asked Bosephus. "Not one," said Ivar. "Certain?" "Dead sure," said Ivar. Lucephus fell silent. Ivar eased the safety off his gun. Ivar heard two slugs strike off the wall above him, felt chips of stone spat down at him. He listened to Bocephus reload. Dead? Asked Bocephus.
Dead?
Ivar said nothing. I can hear you breathing, Bocephus yelled. Are you going to answer the question posed to you by your superior? I'm not dead, said Ivar. Sir, he added. I'm sorry to hear that, said Bocephus. Request of Cuerpo next time you see him to kill you. Inform him this is an order mandated from the top. Ivar listened to Bocephus grunt, heard feet scuffle a bit on the stone, heard something hit ground far below, outside the wall. Or you kill him for all I care, Bocephus shouted up from below. Somebody killed somebody, for God's sake. Yes, sir, shouted Ivar. You won't forget, said Bocephus. No, sir, said Ivar. You have to swear, said Bocephus. I swear it, said Ivar. Kill somebody, shouted Bocephus, his voice receding. I ask the smallest of things.